and thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. One of my many things I'm extremely passionate about is empowering staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise. It's why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss issues, challenges, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I have my very good friend and excellent speaker, Rob Mosely, with Next Level Exchange to join me. Rob is managing partner of Next Level Exchange, a global learning collaborative dedicated to the executive search and staffing industry. Rob comes from MRI Network Corporate, where he served as the chief learning officer, responsible for all training and sales development for more than 1,100 offices worldwide. Rob's knowledge of the executive search and staffing industry comes with 12 years with both Merritt Hawkins and Associates and his subsidiaries, Staff Care, all now part of the MNN Healthcare. Rob served as Vice President of Corporate Business Development. Rob is a keynote speaker and a facilitator at the continuing education seminars in the areas of business-to-business sales execution with a focus on consultative client development, negotiation strategy, team effectiveness, and performance management. Past credits include Staffing Industry Analyst Executive Forum, the Healthcare Forum, the American Staffing Association, the National Association of Personnel Services, also known as NAPS, the National Association of Physician Recruiters, and National Association of Locum Tenens Organization. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Rob Mosely. Welcome, Rob.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Julianne. And that's all we have time for today. You were way too kind in your introduction, and I appreciate that. I would add to that that I've had the privilege of working with Tricom and absolutely love what you do and what you all bring to our network and our executive search and staffing family. So thank you.
No, thank you. And it has been a pleasure when we've worked together, and we look forward to working with you again in fall. During our last conversation, you said some things that really struck me and really piqued my curiosity, and I had to learn more. And so I'm going to paraphrase something that you said that really started our conversation for today's meeting. And that's what I really want to dig into. If I recall right, you said everything we say and do with prospects, clients, and our candidates has an effect one way or the other. And what we know is that people judge us very quickly. In less than a few seconds, they have categorized you and your services by your behaviors, communication style, and with a few minutes, they start to form lasting judgments about you, your approach, and your organization. How are you being treated? Are you a trusted advisor, knowledgeable subject matter, an expert, or just another vendor? What you talked about then is the common biases that are very likely in place before we even begin to open up these conversations. That struck me really interesting. It was like, really? And then you talked about cognitive bias. What is cognitive bias?
Yeah. And I think it's one of the most interesting challenges that we have in our industry today, connecting with clients and candidates, earning the right to be able to do that. And I'll start with even a bigger picture before we get into cognitive bias. If you think about our industry, we do a pretty good job throughout search and staffing about branding ourselves. But for all the cool brands and logos and social media touches, the ultimate brand every day is us. Mm-hmm. It's what each one of our people is saying or failing to say in every conversation. And the challenge I think we have is in the first few seconds, just like everybody on this podcast is doing, people are thinking trust, don't trust. Legitimate, not legitimate. Interested in my world and what I do, or just interested in their own agenda. And once that decision is made, it's something we're going to get into called anchoring. So we have a few seconds, if we're lucky, a few minutes to challenge a perception or a misperception about our value or potential value to clients and candidates.
So does it matter then? So you feel that we can change a bias? We can look at it and work with that bias.
Yeah, we can. And let me give attributes where they are deserved In this study, a couple of years ago, a wonderful mentor and colleague introduced me to an American psychologist by the name of Daniel Kahneman. Daniel Kahneman wrote, it was a New York Times bestseller, called Thinking Fast and Slow. Great read. If you're looking for a fun holiday read, it's pretty riveting. I would even suggest that what you will read about doesn't just apply to the search and staffing industry. It probably applies to making it and surviving through the holidays with your relatives when mm-hmm. they all have strong opinions. Mm-hmm. But what he said, which was interesting, is that, and by the way, just a little more background on him. As an American psychologist, what he was known for is something called cognitive bias. And he's also, he was a Nobel Prize winner for something called prospect theory. And it's a theory about the economy, about how people react, how they respond, how they behave in times of uncertainty. Well, bingo. And if we're not going through that, I don't know what we are doing. And so I thought, wow, times of uncertainty, we deal with that every day. And that's what our clients and candidates are feeling every day. You know, do I act? Do I not act? Do I move? Do I not move? Do I hire? Do I not hire? And in this, he started talking about this idea of cognitive bias, which are behaviors, and I'll simplify this. He does a much more elaborate job of defining it, but they are behaviors that we exhibit, but we're not necessarily aware that we're exhibiting them. And we all do it. This is a universal thing. This isn't a right or wrong. It's not a judgment. They are simply how we all behave when we are faced with uncertainty. I found four that I hope we get a chance to talk about today that I think are particularly applicable in conversations with clients and candidates.
Definitely. I really want to dig into those four because you say they constantly play a role in our complex business decisions that we make. And let's dig into those four that you found to be playing a role in our decisions.
Well, the first one is called loss aversion. And what loss aversion says is, as human beings, the fear of losing something is much greater, twice as great, as the equal opportunity to gain that same thing. We would much rather not gain $1,000, miss that opportunity, than we would actually lose $1,000. We are risk adverse. And as you start thinking about some of the old adages you hear growing up, some of the phrases, better the devil you know than the one you don't, right. A bird in the hand is worth two in the bush. That's all built off the human behavior of loss aversion. And if you think about this, it really does make sense, right? The idea of a significant gain is nice, but I'm much more fearful of a loss. Here's a good example. Airline tickets. Only two left at this price. Fear of loss.
Right. Right.
By the way, there's an entire industry built off this. It's called Las Vegas. People will go out of their way to recover a loss. Well, that's exactly what Vegas is built on, loss aversion, on the human behavior of this fear. Now, what's interesting about this, I think, Julianne, is that if you're talking about this and how it applies to clients and candidates, how we position an opportunity or the loss of an opportunity plays a critical factor in how they respond to it. Now, I am not suggesting fear mongering. I'm not suggesting a doomsday approach, but the idea of what could be loss has a much more powerful psychological impact on someone than the equivalent gain.
Wow. Because, I mean, we see that all the time is that when someone is saying, I hate this job, or I hate this provider. So you offer them the solution that is far better than what they have today, but they can't pull the plug because they know the evil that they're in. They're adverse to that risk of going to the next best, even though they know it's better. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Yes, and I want to make this comment because it's true for politics, it's true in societal norms, in some of the things happening with the Supreme Court. If you take all the heat and the emotion out of that, all those responses, I'll get to this in just a second, but all those responses are not because someone's a good person or a bad person. It's because it is ingrained in our behavior, which means I can step back from the emotion the moment in terms of thinking, well, what's that candidate thinking? What's that client thinking? And step back and say, all right, how can this be course corrected? And the answer to all this is going to be through education, through the demonstration of legitimacy, through offering additional information, through our subject matter expertise. That's not a magic bullet, but it's how we can help work somebody through loss aversion. And that kind of brings us, it ties in with this second cognitive bias, which is called anchoring. And this is the one I find fascinating. And anchoring says that as human beings, we have an over-reliance on either the first information we hear or the one that is what I would call disproportionately influences us. It's something that's really strong and vivid. Hmm. It's why many people, rather than reading the science of something, which doesn't sound all that fascinating, right? No one can wait to, you know, go through the Journal of American Medicine, discuss stuff. We'd rather go to the internet because it's much more vivid and interesting. Mm-hmm. And it's not because I'm saying anyone is smart or dumb or right or wrong. Just take all that out for a second. It's because we as human beings have an over-reliance on either the first thing we hear or the most vivid thing we hear. It's why growing up, the things that you learn get recorded into your memory. And sometimes it's hard to lose those as an adult.
Right.
Those
right.
things are embedded into our DNA. An anchoring would be this, and apply to clients and candidates. A client saying, hey, why wouldn't anyone want to come work with us? We've offered this same base rate for 5 years and get great companies. I'm not moving that. Anchoring. A candidate, hey, I'm worth this much in the marketplace. Right? I'm not taking anything for less than X. Those are all anchors. I think the two thing that's important too is, again, is that order affects the impact. The things we've heard earlier on or that first vivid piece sticks with us. You see this, and I'll use my own, I'll throw myself under the bus. During the whole pandemic, early on, I became on a first name basis with every employee at Total Wine and More. And
not a bad
thing. I had my, right? I don't know, judgment here. I had my favorite bottle, okay, my favorite case of red wine. And my anchor was X amount of dollars for this bottle or case of red wine.
Right.
Became a really good anchor, by the way. So suddenly when things open up this last spring, we get to go out to the restaurant, I'm out on a patio, it's a beautiful day, and I order that same bottle of red wine from the restaurant, and it is 3 times more expensive than what I paid. And I'm like, what? This is outrageous. Well, no, it's just that my anchor has been challenged.
Right.
My anchor is this. As human beings, we have this huge need for comparisons, right? If you go out and go house shopping, I'm going to find the price point that I feel is right for me, and I will use that as a comparison for what is more expensive or less expensive than what I'm getting.
Mm-hmm.
It's really interesting. The vivid thing of this too also is true. Have you known people who grew up who maybe as a child, they were bitten by a dog and they've had a lifelong fear of any kind of animals?
Right.
It doesn't matter whether it's logical or not. It's their fear. It's embedded. Or someone who maybe had a fear of water because of a possible drowning accident. Those vivid pieces are anchored in us. Right. And so it does make a difference. And so what's interesting about anchoring is we see this all the time. Here's something that's interesting. As I'm starting conversations with clients and candidates, one of my important critical tasks is to start to understand what their anchor is. Because only as I start to understand that anchor can I begin to make professional recommendations and suggestions, provide education, legitimacy, expertise to attempt to move that anchor.
So I know you have to listen. I mean, that's half of our problem as a salesperson is really listening to the client or the candidate. But so how are you hearing those anchors? I mean, how you really have to pay attention.
Yeah, you do. And I want to make this comment. Their anchor may not necessarily be wrong, right? Because it's our anchor that we also have to look at. This is one of the best places to start this conversation is in the mirror. Mm-hmm. What are my anchors? What are my beliefs about those things? And how can I challenge myself? That's a good place. But you're right. Going after this as mano a mano, or well, let me tell you, is not going. That's going to embed an anchor even farther. So the ability, as we are diagnosing, and I love the word you just used, it's listening, and I'll even say this: it's listening and acknowledging somebody's position. It doesn't mean you agree. It doesn't mean you're telling them they're right. You're saying, "I hear you. Mm-hmm. I get it, and I'd like to know more."
Right.
So if someone says, "Hey, look, Rob, I like what's on your contract." Let's say it's a client conversation. I like what's on the contract, but we got to the clause here on the replacement guarantee, and we're not comfortable with a 90-day provision. As a matter of fact, we'd have to insist on a six-month replacement guarantee with a full money-back provision if your candidate leaves or is fired for a lack of performance. There's a lot of anchors there.
Right.
So I could run into, well, no, we can't do that, or, well, that's not what the industry standard is. I think a more appropriate response to help shift that anchor, right? Because I'm not sure exactly why he's asking me that or why that's important to him, right? That's his anchor, is this. Mr. Client, I appreciate your desire for a strong replacement guarantee. Right? That's the acknowledgement. And I ask you a couple of questions just so we're on the same page. By replacement guarantee, just so we're sure, what does that look like to you contractually? But I can't even be sure before I know what the anchor is that we're on the same page. Replacement guarantee can mean different things to different people. Mm-hmm. My second question to uncover the anchor is probably this. What's happened in your firm or in your organization historically to make this a contractual requirement? What has been your experience in the past? Was it quality of candidate? Was it promises not fulfilled? Was it, I mean, there's a lot of things I can uncover to understand what that anchor is. So, you know, you think about every day, we, in the industry, we preach, listen and acknowledge. Ask good, open-ended, diagnostic questions with the intent to understand, not to respond, just mm-hmm. to understand, right? And also what I love about this, Julianne, is it, you know, my adage at my old age is, I reserve the right to be smarter in a few minutes, and I need time to think. So what this is buying us in the diagnostic process is time to think, to understand what that anchor is, so I can reply with my legitimacy, with industry expertise, with white papers, with testimonials, with proof of assurance. Mm-hmm. And if I do that, the other added bonus here is that I'm building trust.
Right. Wow.
We throw that word around all the time, but, mm-hmm. you know, and we call it a soft skill. I think it's the hardest darn thing you'll ever do. I mean, you don't believe it, you ask your significant other, you ask your closest friends. It's a tough skill to build over time.
It is, right, right. But wow, excellent. Thank you. So let's go into the third one, the third cognitive bias.
I'm gonna have you play with me on this because it's kind of fun. Let's think about for this third one, the brand Nike. When I say Nike, what do you visualize first?
Well, the little thing, and then that, the saying,
the swoosh.
Just do it. Then, of course, just
exactly. Mm-hmm. Just do it, right? That brand probably sits on every one of our kids' clothing at some point, right? If it's not their shoes, it's arguably the world's most recognizable brand.
Definitely,
it is not. It is not human nature. The brand for human nature would be do nothing.
Right.
And that brings us to the third cognitive bias called default and status quo. And if you think about it, they are two sides of the same coin. Status quo says, when in doubt, do nothing. And default says, we're going to go with what we've done previously. So again, I go to those adages that are so timeless, better the devil you know than the one you don't, mm-hmm. default status quo. A bird in the hand is worth two in the bush, right? That's aversion, that's default status quo. And you see this in a lot of interesting different ways. We all saw it in our industry in about April and May and June of 2020, when for a while everybody shut down and they pulled back.
Mm-hmm.
They were fearful, and we were in a global time of uncertainty. So you saw people do nothing.
Right.
And they said, no, I'm not hiring. I'm not doing this. I'm going to stick with what I have. And again, this isn't a good or bad. This is not a judgment. This is understanding that human beings are wired in a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
And I won't go here, but I think it's a worthwhile conversation. And this is for home for the holidays. I'm going to take a controversial subject, but don't worry, you won't have to pull the plug. So the idea, because I think if we step back from the emotion, it's fascinating. The idea of to vaccinate or not to vaccinate, that personal choice that someone makes. If you take the politics and the emotion out of it, what you've got there is a really interesting cognitive set of biases about the first, the most vivid information someone heard, what they trust the most, the false status quo, which says, hey, I've never had the flu. No one I know's had this, right? I'm just going to stick with the status quo. So again, I'm no judgment, but I think stepping back makes us, first of all, kinder to each other, more aware that no one's being stupid or being bad or being evil, all those things. We all are built on a model as human beings, and we're all pretty much alike in terms of our human response. And I think that allows us to approach some of this stuff with a lot more empathy, bringing it back home, particularly with clients and candidates in those early conversations. You want me to go to the fourth one? We can do that.
Sure. Let's go with the fourth.
And you start to see, too, that these interact, right? They all kind of play off each other. Now, by the way, guys, if you read Kahneman's book, he'll go through a lot of biases. There are many more than this. I just found these four to be particularly appropriate and impactful and relevant for our industry. And the fourth one's called myopia. And it is the human tendency for immediate gratification. And because of that, we tend to think short-sighted in our responses to stuff. As human beings, we really don't like to delay gratification, right? I would much rather spend money than I would save money.
Right.
I would, candidates, my own sister-in-law did this, and I watched it. She had a job for 20 years that she loved, and the company went through a big merger, and they just kind of cleaned people out. So she was having to find a career in the first time in 20 years. And wasn't that educated on the market. And I was not her recruiter. I'm family, right? So I'm staying out of that. But it was interesting as I saw her panic and run to the first thing she could find that would give her a paycheck. Even though she got a nice, severance, all those things, that immediate human response, I'm just going to pick something that I know will get me a paycheck. And down the line, I'll do the homework and the study it takes to find something that I like better. We see politicians do this. I mean, how rare is a bipartisan decision, right? They do the easy stuff, but they kick the tough stuff down the road. So you really do see it in a lot of different areas. This is also true in terms of your perceptions of the world. Now, here's what's interesting about all four of these. If you look at loss aversion, if you look at myopia, if you look at default status quo, as you look at anchoring, one of the things that moves all of these is pain. Pain has an impact on how people respond to these things. That's not something you can necessarily bring to the table. It's something you can point out if it's appropriate and apparent. But pain will have an impact on people. It's kind of like someone saying, well, again, I'm not getting the shot, and then suddenly a loved one gets extremely sick.
Right.
That's pain. That's a fear of loss. That may impact their thought process. We also see it, in our neighborhoods, right? If suddenly you get a rash of teenagers that are thieves in your neighborhood, suddenly we have a terrible crime problem.
Right.
I mean, it's that fear of pain. It changes my idea about how we are. So being aware of pain points, we talk about that a lot in our industry, understanding someone's pain, understanding their problems and challenges, is also part of you uncovering how to potentially work through some of these areas of cognitive bias.
Okay. Can we dig into that a little bit? Like when you understand the biases, How do you reframe that conversation when the client says, I don't need you, no budget, all those things, or candidate says, how do you get my name? They shut you down right from the beginning because they really are putting those biases up front for you, right? How do you work through that conversation or reframe that conversation to open those doors and start, you know, getting that dialogue going?
Yeah. Well, first of all, there is no magic bullet, and there's no guarantee that each one of those conversations will somehow magically change if I, you know, say this word or ask this question. It's a process. I do think, and this goes back to planning for a conversation. One of the things we know early on that's critical is us to build trust early in the conversation, because trust is a key to earning the right to moving somebody's anchor or giving them a different paradigm, right? That's not something that's going to happen in one or two states. I've got to be trusted and be seen as trustworthy to earn that right. That's a tough gig in the first couple of minutes of a conversation. So one of the things we always talk about is reframing how we approach an early conversation with a client or a candidate. Now, this is also true, Julianne, for I think a current long-lasting relationship. You and I just did it with each other. Early on, the first thing we did before we started this podcast is we both did a relate with each other. We shared a little insight about each other. What'd you do for Thanksgiving? Did you enjoy it? Did you have a good time? All those are what I call sources of insight and relates. There's a fun mantra that says, the more interested I am in you, the more interesting I'm going to be to you. So one of the things we talk about in a new conversation, right after the introduction, you know, my name is Rob Mosely, managing partner with Next Level Exchange. I want to be right out of the gate and convey that I'm prepared for the call, which says, hey, in preparation for this, I've noticed that your organization has recently gone through a merger and you're introducing a new product line. It's also come to my attention that your background with this industry started at this firm. I work, and it, right, that's what's saying, I know your world, I speak your language, I've done my homework. That's a different kind of conversation right off the bat. Here's the good news about that. If you are a newer associate, that stuff you can prepare for and plan, and you can fake it till you make it.
Right.
But what we're doing is setting up this as I'm prepared, I know something beyond the obvious about you, your role, your title, or industry, and we're going to use that to turn it into a conversation. You know, Julianne, in speaking with other CEOs in your space, I'm hearing these two concerns as being primary. How is that, does that compare with what you see in the marketplace? Mm-hmm. And what I'm doing is earning the right to trust. I think too often we get into the got a chicken, need a chicken, want a chicken,
right?
And trust goes out the window. So I think we got to reframe how we have our conversation. So I suggest this: introduce, share insight, which takes some preparation. By the way, you can do that canned. If you work in the healthcare industry, you can come up with 10, what I call critical sound bites, positioning statements. Mm-hmm. That says, here's our pulse on the marketplace. And you want to share that and turn that into the third piece, which is called the inquire. Ask some early diagnostic questions. It's not a magic bullet, but it's a different approach. And I always say this, if you fail to differentiate by your approach, you're going to end up having to differentiate by your price.
Right.
So that's one thing, is establish trust early by sharing that you know something about them, their role, their title, or the interest beyond the obvious.
Wow, I love that, because so many times I get calls and I hang up right away because their whole focus is to sell. And they, half the time, they don't even know anything about the company. They haven't done their research at all. And to me, you're right. You don't build the trust at all. If you don't know the research about me or the company, why am I spending time with you? So that's how I would look at it. Now, that could be a pretty strong opinion, but my time is valuable. And we have to realize that everybody's time is valuable. We're running around. We're doing a lot of things. We got a lot of hats up in the air. We're tossing balls up in the air, I should say. So you got to value their time. And the only way you value your time is, like you said, gain insight on the business before you open up that door, before you start talking to them.
No.
Yeah. No, I think this is really good.
I love it.
Sorry.
I'd also suggest this, Julianne, and you said something that's really critical. Looking in the mirror and saying, what would cause me to actually listen to a voicemail or to actually respond to an email instead of going delete, 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 or give someone more than 2 seconds and just say, no, I'm not interested. What would it take? And I think your answer to that is probably true for other human beings as well. Mm-hmm. This idea of building trust is certainly one of them, and legitimacy. You also mentioned something else I just wanted to touch on because I think it's huge. Early resistance, right? No matter how good we are at opening a conversation, it's just natural that, you know, our clients see this as an imposition on their day. We're all busy people. And if you're going to get pushback, I've always found that it's typically in one of these five forms. No need, no budget, not me, not now, not ever. How we respond to that early pushback or resistance is either going to drive the dialogue forward or destroy it. And you just don't always get a second chance. You just mm-hmm. don't. So the ability, I think, to get out of the gate with those positioning statements, with great diagnostic questions beyond just the obvious, I think is huge. It's mm-hmm. not perfect, but it helps differentiate you early on.
Yeah, and I think you talked about it in your presentations as more the resistance versus overcoming objections, right? Is don't go at the objection, look at the resistance and form your approach based on that. And so can you go into that? Because you've talked a lot about that.
Yeah. And talk me down off my pedestal if I get crazy about this.
Well, no, because I love one of your models you use. I'm trying to learn that and use that in my conversations with people.
There's a great mantra that says the language determines the conversation. The conversation determines the relationship, and that relationship determines your outcome or success. Our words matter. They're important. I find it ironic that in an industry that says we want to collaborate, we want to partner, if you go into any team meeting and listen to the verbiage we use to describe our clients and candidates, it sounds like we're in a fist fight with them. All right, we need to get out there and target that market. I want you to penetrate that account. We need to overcome their objections. You know, if I'm your client or candidate, I have absolutely no desire to be targeted, penetrated, and overcome. Nothing to me sounds collaborative about that. I do want to be advised. I want to be consulted with. I want to partner with someone. And so I think language is important. I'll tell you what, we get called vendors all the time. Mm-hmm. Go look up the definition of vendor in the American Heritage or Webster Dictionary. You will never want to be called a vendor again.
I hate that name.
A commoditization. So with that, I think this idea of it's not objections, it's resistance. And by the way, resistance is a good thing. It's indifference that's our enemy. And I'm thinking about that for a second. It is indifference we're hearing from somebody because we don't look different from the other 15 calls they're getting from vendors wanting something from them. So we talk about responding to resistance. And what we know is that any kind of resistance, either from a client or a candidate, is going to come in one of three forms. And by the way, as you listen to this, these are all also cognitive biases. All four of those biases are in these resistance. It's either a misperception, and by the nature of the beast, clients and candidates don't know they have a misperception. None of us do. No. And last time I checked, nobody wants to be told they're wrong.
Right.
So how I clarify a misperception, how I provide legitimacy and expertise education is critical. If it's not a misperception, it's what we call a skepticism. And a skepticism is when someone is questioning our legitimacy or expertise. You know, well, Julianne, you're in Wisconsin. Our search firm is located in Florida. I'm skeptical you could understand the needs of someone halfway across the country with our specific needs. That's questioning our legitimacy or credibility. If it's not a misperception, if it's not a skepticism, the third is a factual concern, which means it's real. Hey, the last time I worked with you, Rob, the candidates were not as we had discussed and were not qualified. And the one we chose left with, you know, before their replacement guarantee period. We're not interested in working with you. That's real. That's a problem. That's a concern. So I have to source where the resistance is coming from so that I can start working on those anchors, on their fear of loss, on a short-sighted response to something. You know what? We're fine. We're happy with who we're working with. Default status quo. Does that kind of help tie that in just a little bit?
It does. It really does. Can you go into, I love it. So can you go into the model that I'm trying to really understand and practice in my conversations, the LACES? Can you, because I think that's really, especially when you talk about like acknowledge, I am really trying to practice when I hear something from somebody, I restate, this is what I heard from you. To like to restate that I correctly heard it, to acknowledge that I'm hearing their concerns or their bias or whatever it is, so that they know I'm really listening to them. So go through what LACES all stands for to our listeners and kind of each of those acronyms. Well, it's an acronym and it stands for certain words.
Yeah, sure. And thank you for bringing that to all of our attention. It is something that intellectually we would all say, yeah, I got it. Check the box. I do that. Behaviorally, in the moment, when we've got a client or a candidate coming at us and we're not sure, we tend to throw it out the window and we grow right into what I call tell mode. Well, let me tell you, here's why we do this. Mm-hmm. And what I've just done is change the dynamics of the conversation. So we created a tool called LACES, to your point, that's five steps. And it's not scripted, which means you can put your own words, your verbiage, your art and craft on top of the science of how we respond, which also helps us uncover these biases. Because in the process of leveraging LACES, I can start to uncover some of these cognitive biases. The five steps stand for listen, for what's said and what's not being said, for the feelings behind the emotion. The next step is acknowledge. And again, that means not to necessarily say we agree. It says, I hear you, and what you say is important. Julianne, I loved what you just said. It's the idea of seeking first to understand and making sure that we acknowledge or pair it back. What I just heard you say is this. Do I have that right? Mm-hmm. If I'm hearing you, you just said this. Sometimes you're sensing it. And I sense, Julianne, that you are frustrated with this conversation. So it's just letting people know that you hear them and what they have to say is important, whether you agree or disagree. The third step is clarification, what I like to call clarifying questions. To make sure that we're on the same page, let me ask you a couple of questions about what you just said, what I'd like to know. And that clarification, those open-ended clarifying questions, cannot be asked with the intent to win or have a one-up. They have to legitimately be non-accusatory, which means we need to keep them pretty open-ended. Who, what, when, where, why. Now, I might stay in the what I call listen, acknowledge, clarifying questions. I might stay in that loop for a while. Okay. And until I'm ready to take the fourth step, which is expand, which is to make a guiding suggestion, a professional recommendation, an early suggestion for a direction, kind of a litmus test, just to test the waters. It could be providing additional legitimacy. So the expand is to provide a recommendation to move forward. And the S is to seek agreement, which can be simple. Does that sound like a good next step? How does that look to you? What have I answered your question fully? Whatever that trial close is. So listen, acknowledge, clarifying questions, expand to provide some additional thoughts and ideas, and seek agreement to move forward. It is common sense. It is very rarely common practice. And if you don't believe me, you go home and ask your significant other.
You're right.
This is, again, is a great holiday gift. Take this and leverage it when you're with your kids when you go home. You just put it right on your notes and see. And you'll see that most of us, we don't listen. We talk and wait to talk. We don't acknowledge what somebody said. We don't ask a clarifying question. We go right to the E. Well, let me tell you why we do this. Mm-hmm. With that finger point, right? Right. And that just changed the dynamics of the whole conversation. Mm-hmm. Suddenly you'll get this.
Right. So are you suggesting, Rob, that you stay, when you say you stay in that LA, the listen, acknowledge, acknowledge and clarify, So when you're hearing things, you just keep on asking more questions that you don't try to expand on your reputation. When you hear the first issue, you keep on going in and do you kind of like line up the item? So you're getting more and more understanding, acknowledgement, clarifying it so that you have it. And then you say, okay, now based on you have maybe three or four issues or concerns, then you can say, based on our reputation or my expertise, this is how I've approached this in the past, or this is my solution for this.
I believe it's been my personal experience that taking a few minutes to ask at least one or two clarifying questions and acknowledge their position is one of the most powerful things I can do to build trust early, to let them know that I'm interested in them. It also gives me a few minutes to think about how I want to position this. And I get it. I know for a lot of our tenured folks out there, you can probably lip sync the conversations you're having with candidates. I think approaching that candidate conversation like it's the first time you've ever heard this and say, tell me more about that. What has your experience been? How does this compare with what you're seeing? Even if I know what I'm getting ready to position, is really important. If I say it, it's suspect. If you say it, it's true. So if I can get my client candidate to engage early and tell me their truth, I can build on that. And that's a powerful expand. If I can build on what they tell me, it's going to be a lot more relevant than something I might want to share with them.
I fully agree with you. I think we're so quick to get to the sale, to close the sale, that we have forgotten the whole process of the candidate or the client of what their needs are and really listening in and digging into what they're, if you really want to solve or help them or really gain their confidence, their trust as a candidate or a client, you really got to, you have to get to know them. And so quick, we just go from, oh, I heard this, I'm going to solve it right away for you. Yeah, we can do that. And to me, you're just shutting me down. I feel like you're just going right to the sales. You're taking that sales approach again. And so you're really not interested as me as a client. So I totally agree with your philosophy. I really do. It's getting the practice of changing our behavior. And I think it's really critical to now, because candidates, there's not that many out there. You know, it's a tough market. You're up against so many others against that are fighting for the same candidate pool. Clients, we're finding that we're up against the same client pool or prospect pool as many others. So you really have to differentiate yourself in a way that separates not just your service, but also how you approach that sale from the very beginning. That's my philosophy. And I think that's what I'm hearing from you.
Yeah, that's a powerful statement, Julianne. I couldn't agree more. And I'll say this too. This is It's a game of patience, and I know our industry is about urgency. Mm-hmm. That said, you know, you never know what seed you're planting just in these conversations. I remember my first 12 years in retained physician search, and I was on the client development side. I had this hospital administrator who was really admired, and he was always nice enough to take my call or return a message or an email, but it was always, we don't really have a need for your services. He was admittedly, he was in a beautiful location, very desirable, and had a great reputation. 2.5 years later, out of a clear blue, I get a call from him and he says, I want to talk to you about something. I think I have an opportunity for us to work together. And I was shocked. I was stunned. I said, I would look forward to that. I have to ask, you know, pretty consistently not had a need for our services, fortunately for you. What changed? He said, well, he said, you were the only person that was consistent in your approach. You said, you've always kept up with me and it was appropriate. And you always brought something to the table, which let me know you had a pulse on the industry. And when I came to the point I needed somebody, you're the first person I thought to that I trusted. I was 2 years into this thing. And I know for a lot of us, that sounds like a lifetime, but you never know what seeds you're planting and when those seeds might start to sprout. Right. So I think it's a worthy endeavor and a good lifelong practice.
Right. Wow. This has been great. It's good. Rob, I thank you. I mean, we could go on with this for such a long time, and I would love to. I'm sure we should wrap it up. I would like to say thank you to you, Rob, for taking the time to do this. I also want to tell our audience, they really should check you out with Next Level Exchange. You do a lot of training. You've been at many of the industry shows, as we mentioned earlier in the at the beginning of this podcast, and we'll be having you in fall at our show in September here in Milwaukee. I really encourage people, because you have great material. You're a great coach, I look at it, and teacher to us, that we do need to learn how to change our approach, how to slow it down, how to really form a relationship with the client or the candidate before we try to sell them. But thank you. Anything else you want to say in closing?
No, just that I'm honored to be a part of your organization and the ongoing learning and development that you bring. You raise the bar. A rising tide raises all boats. So thank you for the opportunity. Except in the fall, I think we get into that favorite glass of wine of mine, and we get to have one and toast in person. I would love that.
That would be great. I would love to do that. I'm a big wine lover, so that would be great. Rob, thank you very much. I appreciate your time. This is great insight. I look forward to using your information. I'll keep in touch and tell you how well I'm doing with it. I'll probably learn in fall a couple times. But you just have to keep at it, right? Just keep trying.
You know what? I can't tell you how many times I've taught this all day long, and I come home and I get this. Hey, Rob, you do teach this stuff, right? So we all reserve the right to be better at this stuff tomorrow. We just do. We're human beings.
We're in constant learning. That's what we should be about. So thank you. And this is it. Wrapping it up with Rob Mosely with Next Level Exchange. Thank you. Bye.